leaves from the vine, all of the sad memes, and actually all of the memes now make a ton of sense because I finished book 3 of Avatar The Last Airbender. Wow. What's going on, you guys? James here with another Real Review, and today I'm taking a look at the series finale, the final book of Avatar The Last Airbender, that is book 3. Wow.
Wow.
If you've missed out on any of my Avatar The Last Airbender content, guys, I watched it for the very first time, so please go back in the channel. There's a link down below in the description for the playlist where I have all my reviews and reactions all the way up to the end of book 3. It's fantastic. And that's my review, guys. Have a great day. No. Totally kidding. Now, before I get started talking about why this series is just so excellent, if it's your first time here at the channel, welcome to Real James, guys. I talk about TV, talk about movies, and I review them and I react to them. So if you don't want to miss out on anything, please go ahead, support the channel, and hit the big red button below and subscribe to the channel. Now, don't forget to tap on that bell as well, just to stay up to date with anything new that drops. You're also going to want to go ahead and smash that like button if you can, because guys, it helps the channel a ton. And go ahead and get loud in the comments below and let me know which moment of season 3 was your favorite. And if you want to get nuts, go ahead and tell me which moment from the entire series is the best moment of Avatar The Last Airbender. Now, okay, we're gonna get into what I liked, and the one thing, okay, maybe there are two things that I didn't like about book 3, but if you're familiar with my book 1 and book 2 reviews, I did something called a wow compilation, where it's just like a quick montage of moments that wowed me. It's not every moment, because wow, season 3 had a ton of moments, but we're gonna get into it. Let's do it. Wow compilation coming right up. Aang has hair now? Huh. So that's what the Fire Lord looks like. I mean, Phoenix King, but he's the Fire Lord. Whatever. If Aang and Katara do not get together in this season, boy, I'm gonna be upset. Ooh, ooh, ooh. That's how I look on the dance floor too, Aang. Ooh, ooh, what's this? Oh, I can't do a backflip. Nope, I'm out. Iroh hasn't said a single word in like 4 episodes. Is he even still here? Oh, never mind. Iroh's back. Yeah, he's ripped. He's got a 16-pack. My gosh. Is that Cyclops from X-Men and Avatar? Yeah, okay. Wow, that's crazy. Universe crossover there. All right. Bloodbending. Oh my gosh. Oh, why are the noises? Stop, stop, stop. The noises are loud. Oh my gosh. Katara girl, you are strong. You know, I really wish we had more Appa. Hold up. Aang and Katara are together? Oh no. No, she said she was confused. Okay, never mind. Well, dang, I guess it's gotta be Zuko and Katara now, right? They're teasing us. They fought side by side and they were training together. It's gotta be. Never mind. No. No, 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 no. Aang and Katara are definitely together. I'm going back and forth here. Anyway. What is this thing? Oh, a lion turtle. Okay, so there's a lion turtle. There's Melon Lord. There's so many different creatures in this series. My goodness. Iroh gets his tea shop. Heck yeah. Well, guys, I was gonna talk about how Aang and Katara kissed at the end of the season, but I might as well show you.
Oh, yes!
Alright, guys, that was so much fun, and I cannot believe it was the final WoW compilation for Avatar The Last Airbender. Maybe I should do one for Legend of Korra. We'll see. Now, guys, let's get right into book 3 and what made it so great. Now, like I mentioned, there were a couple things I didn't like, but before we hop into that, let me go down the list of some of the best episodes of this season and the one episode I was not feeling. You'll know it if you've been keeping up with me, but we'll go through it together. Okay, so right at the top of the list for best episodes is Sokka's Master. Now, that doesn't mean it's the best episode, but man, Giancarlo Volpe directed one of the best episodes of this series, because what it did for me wasn't just simply, oh, it's a Sokka solo episode. It gave context to his character. It gave more of a foundation to his character, really, because he was the only one of the group that didn't have bending abilities. And because of that, he was always trying to find different ways to help the group, and he felt so secluded because, man, I'm always falling behind. However, in Sokka's Master, he was able to go and learn how to handle a sword, for goodness sakes, and it definitely pays dividends at the end of the season, because you saw him when he was like trying to help Toph up and stuff, and he used the sword to like, you know, knock over the enemies of the Fire Nation. And then there's the Avatar and the Fire Lord, directed by Ethan Spaulding. That was not an episode I really thought was going to go in the direction it did, if that makes a lot of sense. If you want to go back and check out my reaction, because you guys asked me to react to that episode, and it makes a ton of sense, because that's when Zuko found out about his destiny. Wow, that was quite the episode. And then there's The Day of Black Sun Part 1, directed by Giancarlo Volpe. Let me tell you, I liked it better than Part 2, maybe because I'm here for the action, but the thing about Avatar that really spoke to my heart as an audience member and just as a critic even alone was the character development, and there was much more of that in part one. I felt more sympathy for the characters. It was just so much more emotional. Collectively, they're great, but part one to me is much better than part two. And then I gotta be honest with you guys, Sozin's comment, even though Netflix originally broke it up from parts one to part four, and now it's of course collectively together, that finale is the best series finale that I might have ever witnessed on television. Now, when it comes to the list of worst episodes, there's only one episode here, and I wouldn't say it's necessarily a bad episode of The Last Airbender. It just doesn't rise to the standards of the previous episodes and the episodes to follow it. The Ember Island Players. Now, you and I, we talked about this, and yes, I get it. It's a very unique retelling of the series up to this point, and it's a nice recap episode without it really being a recap episode, because there is something at the end that propels the plot forward, but it's just not very good. It was very self-aware. Yes, it was funny in moments, but I just felt like maybe I was looking forward because this is the episode that predates the final episodes for the Last Airbender. So yeah, I was just disappointed. I didn't necessarily hate it. I just didn't really rise up to the expectations that some people were hyping it up to be. So I really don't want to go ahead and recap this season because, guys, listen, I know I was late to the Avatar train, but you guys have seen this season and this series really multiple times, more than me, of course. So let's just get into how I'm looking at this season. I mean, we're gonna start with, where does this season rank? You guys, some of you guys told me that season 3 was better than season 2, and then there were a lot of people that said book 2 was much better than the third. I'm gonna be honest with you guys, I agree with the crowd that says book 2 is better than book 3. That's not to say again that book 3 is bad, because it's an excellent season of television in general, but I found book 2 to just be so special, and it has my favorite episode of the entire series, Zuko Alone, and I'll tell you why that was my favorite episode as we get further down this list. Book 2 has a lot of character development, and book 3 has a ton of action, and I think that's why a lot of people did like it. Now, if I'm wrong, let me know, but book 3 has way more action than book 2, and it has that epic conclusion, which is why a lot of people rated it 10 out of 10, and I still rated it 10 out of 10. I just prefer book 2 for all of the character building, the introduction of Toph, and giving her even more of a spotlight, for example, and then you have some of the internal tensions with Aang and the gang on full display, and they have to overcome it. However, I do understand why some people would rank book 3 above book 2, because it is just such an excellent conclusion, and I said it in my reaction, guys, but book 3 is one of the best seasons of television ever, and it made Avatar a top 5 show for me among the ranks of Breaking Bad and The Wire. Now, there are a couple of things that didn't work in this season, and I don't know if you guys agree with me or not, but Combustion Man, who I joked around and said was Cyclops from X-Men, is not necessarily more than just a prop for the plot. He didn't feel like he had much of a role, and the thing is, in books 1 and 2, I came to expect that every character on screen was gonna have some sort of development. Combustion Man was just kind of there. Zuko originally hired him to go after the Avatar and basically kill him, because no one else knew that Zuko did not kill the Avatar. So it was very up in the air for me. Some moments I thought, man, Combustion Man is helping bring so much action to this episode, and then there was another part of me that thought, it just feels like Combustion Man is there, it's just the plot device. And then of course Ember Island Players not being an episode that worked for me, but those are the only two things I didn't care too much for in this season. So what worked in book 3? Let's start with directing. Now, the reason why I thought the directing was excellent is because there was a very consistent tone throughout the entire season. If you didn't know who was directing each episode, you wouldn't necessarily know it was a different director. I really love that in books 1 and 2 there was an identity to each episode, sure, but in book 3 one collective voice really paid off, because you needed that for an epic finale. Now, let me be honest, if you are a diehard fan, you might understand that director Lauren McMullen brought some of the best episodes in books 1 and 2, but I was really sad that she wasn't here for book 3. However, Joaquin Dos Santos really stepped up, and so did Ethan Spalding and Giancarlo Volpe. They did such an excellent job at just kind of weaving in different storylines. And like I mentioned, this animation was beautiful, and it took a lot to really direct certain sequencing of shots, especially in that final battle with the Phoenix King and the Avatar. Insane. How they got everything to kind of flow so nicely is a true testament to the directing that this series has. Oh man, I am just still so blown away. All right, so let's move on to the writing. Now, I'm not over-exaggerating when I say this, and I don't like speaking in hyperbole too much, But the writing here has forever changed the way I'm gonna view other TV shows and movies forever. I'm using the word forever a lot. I think I just said it 4 times. It just came together nicely, guys. If you can't see what I'm doing with my hands, I did this. That means it came together nicely. And I'm not gonna forget about the voice acting, guys, because we've talked about it a little bit. However, I think it's worth mentioning one more time that the voice acting in Avatar The Last Airbender is of a different breed. I know I've never heard voice acting quite like this, because each character was relatable and nothing felt out of place. I felt like each voice matched, even the boulder. The boulder likes voice acting. But let me go ahead and give credit where credit is due. Zach Tyler voicing Aang, fantastic. Jack DeSena voicing Sokka, unreal. Man, Sokka's pain, his happiness, his concern, everything was just beautiful. I mean, heck, Dee Bradley Baker as Appa. Just great. Mae Whitman as Katara. You guys know Katara has been a favorite in the series of mine for quite a while. Dante Bosco as Prince Zuko. Man, the sinister approach and then the more gentle approach that we get in this season, because of course he turned good and more humble, is just a beautiful transition. Michaela Jill Murphy as Toph. Gosh, we'll talk more about Toph soon, but wow. Such an amazing character. Even though Mako wasn't in this season because he did pass away, still loved him as Iroh the entire series up to this point, but his replacement wasn't bad at all. Greg Baldwin, guys, I'm not gonna lie, that was a very spot on job. Grey Griffin as Azula, I mentioned it in my season 2 review, but Grey Griffin was the standout in that season because the way she brings about this sinister approach, while you also understand she's a broken character, all of that is conveyed in the voice acting. So Grey Griffin, wonderful, wonderful job. And then I'm gonna end it on the Phoenix King. I know there are more actors in this season that we can get to, but guys, Mark Hamill, what in the world? Y'all told me he was in this, but I didn't know he was in this. Oh my goodness, Mark Hamill is just fantastic. Okay, now guys, before I go ahead and break down all the characters, because that's something I want to do in this review, is go character by character in our main cast and talk about the way they've changed and just basically show some love, because you guys have very strong opinions about these characters and I love each and every one of them. But we're going to get into right now the section of this season that I felt really overshadowed some moments in a good way. And that is the relationships that are formed in this season. All right, guys, you're gonna have to sound off below, but I asked in a poll which relationship was your favorite. A lot of people said Sokka and Sugi, which is great, but we're gonna start off by talking about the relationship that I wanted to see blossom, and thank God it did. Oh man, Katara and Aang. Now listen, their kiss in the Day of Black Sun Part 1 made me flip out. If you don't believe me, check out my reaction. But yeah, I'm not gonna lie, Aang got a little confident. He figured, oh, she loves me and I love her, so it's gonna be a thing. The thing is, he tried to kiss her again in the Ember Island Players and it did not work out. And honestly, I get it, because Katara was conflicted. I don't understand where people are coming from when they say that Katara and Zuko never really had a thing. I think they did, guys. I mean, they definitely felt a certain type of way, even when they were asked once upon a time, are you boyfriend and girlfriend, and then they blushed together, and then when they were training side by side, the way they kind of would look at each other a little bit longer than usual, it definitely kind of fit, and I figured that was the direction the writers were going to go, and then Aang was going to have to just go off on his own. But I'm kind of glad they stuck with Katara and Aang getting together at the end of Sozin's comment. That was such a genuine moment. I mean, it really did feel like a beautiful ending, and then when you see the end painted across the sky and then the credits roll, it was just such a great way to wrap everything up, because that to me was the penultimate relationship. It was a boy who was discovered and the first person he saw was Katara. Now if I'm wrong, please let me know, but I remember him looking at Katara first and then Katara being so kind of intrigued in terms of where he came from and seeing him grow. Katara felt like she played a big role in his life in that regard, and Katara has been the glue for the entire crew. So I definitely love that they got together, and oh man, imagine if all that happened in the Cave of Two Lovers. That would have really kind of sucked. I'm actually kind of glad it happened at the end of the series. So this seems like a natural segue into Katara and Zuko. We just talked a little bit about it, but let's get into it a little bit deeper. Katara and Zuko have an interesting relationship. I remember at the end of book 2 where Katara was going to heal Zuko and then they were in that crystal cave together. That was the moment where I started to think, is Zuko interested in Katara? Or is it actually the other way around? Katara was the first one among Aang and the gang to really believe in Zuko and understand that he has a bit of good in him. And what's funny is she was the last one to really trust him fully. You guys remember that episode, right? All that blood bending. It was kind of crazy. But the thing is, finally, Katara believed in Zuko and said, "I trust you fully." And actually, if I'm not mistaken, I think she was the one to also push him to lead the crew whenever Aang went missing. So yes, there was so much building here for them to get together. And then Zuko sacrifices himself in front of the lightning when Azula throws it at Katara in that final Agni Kai. Yeah, guys, there was no reason to not think they would get together. But, you know, the series went in a different direction. I really love Zuko and Mai together. I think that it's great, and all of you have made so much sense when you say they both kind of had this thing early on. Mai had a childhood crush on Zuko, and the fact that Zuko and Mai were really normal together and they could be themselves without trying to put on a show for anyone, that was beautiful. And at first I was thinking, you know, this is very cute, but I never bought fully into it until you guys were telling me, hey, this is how you should view it. And you're right, Mai and Zuko really are made for each other, and I think that's the reason the writers made them end up together. And then there's Sokka and Suki. Gosh, I love them together, and I'm so sad that they didn't actually end up together at the end. I mean, you know, Suki went with the Kyoshi Warriors, and then the new addition with Ty Lee, and they went and they probably gonna go help keep the nations in order, you know? And I wanted to see Sokka and Suki stay together, but I get it. And I think that's the growth of Sokka's character too. He came to terms with, hey, I'm not gonna cry over this. We had a thing, but I know your destiny is bigger than my wants right now for us. Who knows, down the line, maybe they end up together. I gotta read the graphic novels. Maybe they kind of come together again. But I love the fact that they were able to build such a mature relationship. And guys, when Suki was held captive by Azula, the fact that Sokka went and basically told Azula, "You better tell me where she is, girl," it was amazing. It felt like he was doing such a great act of service, not only for the crew, because you could tell in that moment he was 110% selfless, but you could tell he really does love Suki, and Suki loves him right back. And man, I really love them. What the heck? You guys, I have one question for you, and I'm hoping you can answer it in the comments. What the heck happened to Toph's interest in Sokka? You remember, they were kind of teasing that, and then all of a sudden it became a total friendship, which is fine, but I felt like there was no natural transition into the friend zone. It almost felt like Toph was, I don't know, just like okay with it because a huge battle and a comet was coming. I get it, it's bigger than a relationship, but like Toph never kind of mentions it ever again. Toph clearly had a crush on Sokka, but maybe she found out that Sokka wasn't interested like that, so she moved on. I don't know. All right, guys, we're gonna get into some of the coolest battles that I could really pick out from this season, and it starts with the final Agni Kai. You all have said it in the comments, we've talked about it, but let me just say it publicly, that is the most beautiful battle of the entire series. Man, the colors, the animation, the music, how the music tells more of a story than the actual fight is beautiful, and I found out from you guys that they did a live score to that. That's incredible, and I really do believe that Zuko and Azula had so much history together, and that's what made the battle great, but it's also because they were both fighting for two different things. One, clearly the good side in Zuko, and Azula was fighting to preserve her, I guess, power among the Fire Nation, and she didn't care about lives at that point. She was unhinged. The way leading up to that final Agni Kai where she's cutting her hair in the mirror and then she sees her mother, it's an illusion. It's all so messy for her. But you can tell Zuko was so controlled and he was so stable. However, he did throw himself in front of the lightning, like we just talked about, to save Katara. And then you have Katara waterbending for her life, literally, and Azula just being kind of crazy with it, right? She's all over the place. And then when Katara freezes Azula and her and then goes and like maneuvers in the middle of waterbending, like in the middle of that little like frozen block of ice that they're in, it's just unreal. And then of course I cannot forget Aang and the Phoenix King Ozai facing off. Guys, I had chills down my body. I mean, it's just insane because you have to think about the amount of work that goes into the animation, right? We know it takes a lot. At least I know it takes a lot. And I spoke to a buddy of mine and he said the amount of time to basically sketch out everything in the middle of different scenes would just have taken forever. And it's true, they must have had so much manpower, the budget must have been through the roof, but it looked great, and I loved how everything felt so together, if that makes sense. It didn't ever feel chaotic, and I could always track the action. And that battle was just unreal. I mean, energy bending, and then Aang is doing this thing where he's combining all the different, you know, earth bending, fire bending, water bending, air bending. I'm like, homie, that's wild. All right, guys. Well, we're gonna get into the story in a couple more sections here. It's a long one, so strap in. I almost should have said get snacks, but thanks for listening. So let's get into the story, because when I tell you that this is a great series, right, that it is a top five series, let me break it down further. This season is among the best of any TV show that I've ever watched. It has the best series finale that I've ever seen, the best. And I really think that when it crafts together each and every story, and then you kind of see how everything played out at the end, it's so perfect that I don't even think they could have done it another way. Sometimes I will critique an ending and think, okay, maybe this should have been done this way. But in Avatar The Last Airbender, it was done exactly how it should have been done. And even though I did say the storyline was perfect, guys, I'm sorry, but I kind of wanted a little bit more Appa and Uncle Iroh. It's just selfish of me. I love those characters so much. Okay, so let's get into it. Let's break down every single character, because, well, it's worth it. Now, I'm saying every single character, I mean all the main cast. You know, I'm not gonna go and break down the Boulder, because, you know, even though he's a fan favorite, and Cabbage Man, definitely a fan favorite as well. But let's get into Aang. The growth of this character was definitely the most apparent. It's the most obvious, because he goes from being frozen underneath water for, what, 100 years? All the way to literally saving the world. If that's not character growth for you, I don't know what is. I know his destiny was to defeat the Fire Lord and, of course, save the world, but if anything, he also was destined to help shape the lives of those he didn't even know existed, right? He didn't know Sokka and Katara were gonna be there for him. He didn't know he was gonna meet Toph, Sugi, even have friends in Appa and Momo. But the thing is, he shaped their lives in many more ways than one. And I think that was the overall destiny of Aang. It was not only to save the world, but it was to change the world. I also love that in this season, the writers show that he was dealing with something internally. He was conflicted. How do I defeat the Fire Lord? Do I kill him or do I try to save him? Ultimately, he did the whole energy bending thing and it was great. But I really do believe that there's a part of Aang that never felt as angry as his Avatar state depicted, right? Because in the Avatar state, he was unhinged. Finally, he controlled it at the end. But yeah, I never thought he was that angry dude, and he was definitely sometimes upset. But internally, I think he was struggling between good and evil, both being frustrated that he missed out on so much of his life, and also because he made these new friends and the Fire Nation is trying to kill him. The empathy of his character, the humbleness, the selflessness, it was just all so beautiful. And another thing I loved about Aang is, here's a boy who missed out on his entire childhood. He spent 100 years frozen underwater, only to be brought back up to the surface and be told, you have to save the world, and hey, you're 12 years old. So you missed out on your childhood. However, it was up to him to decide whether he wanted to let his past define him, or allow his present to refine him. And that was just such a beautiful decision he had to make internally, and eventually he makes the right decision and decides to go and do everything he can to save the world. Alrighty, we're gonna get into Zuko now, guys. Let me be honest, I don't want to offend any of my Katara friends, because I love Katara, and I've said from seasons 1 to 2 that she was my favorite character of the entire series. However, after season 3, I have to be honest with you. Zuko is my favorite character in Avatar The Last Airbender, because I went from hating him to sort of trusting him to hating him again to loving him and understanding his journey. And yeah, the way they crafted his character was just out of this world. And there's something just so beautiful about his relationship with Iroh that helps put him head and shoulders above almost every other character. He didn't want to listen to his uncle. All he wanted to do was get trained on how to capture Aang, capture the Avatar, and get welcomed back into the family. After being exiled as a boy, you know, hey, I guess I can sympathize with him a little bit, but he didn't really want that. He wanted power, right? But eventually, Iroh let him know, hey, you gotta do what's right. You gotta fight for good and not for evil. Trust me, I know. And he listened to his uncle, and that moment where they just they just hug, and you can just feel so vindicated as a fan and think, yes, Zuko is good. Uncle Iroh got his wish. It's so beautiful. And also, Zuko was a really good contrast to Azula because both experienced trauma but handle it differently. Now, see, I love that Zuko was able to be shown as a child with his mother because we got to understand that he was loved as a kid, but he was not getting that love from both parents. He was only getting it from his mother, and his father always looked at him as weak. Okay, moving on to Katara. Now, listen, I love her character. She is the glue for the crew, and I said it earlier in this review and I'll say it again, without her, none of this happens. It really doesn't, because they all either fall off the bandwagon or basically they all get angry at each other. But Katara was the one to really bring everyone together, keep them in the middle, and let them know that not only are they loved, but they're heard. Like, that's the thing about Katara, is that she's always hearing people. She's always listening to people and their feelings. She's empathetic. She's the most emotional in the crew in a good way, because Lord knows I was an emotional wreck watching her interact with people. Man, it was so beautiful. But that's the thing about Katara's character. She loses her mother at a very young age, as we saw in the Southern Raiders, and she grows up to basically be that motherly figure for so many in her tribe. And that's what's incredible, is that such a young woman can go and be that adult figure for others. So she had to be wiser and more mature beyond her years, and Sokka really did look up to her sometimes for that life advice. If it wasn't for Katara, Sokka would still be making misogynistic comments, but hey, here we are. And did I mention the bloodbending? No? Okay, Katara can bloodbend. Crazy. And if there is one line that Katara spoke that defined her character for all three seasons, it's this one. It's when Katara said, "I will never ever turn my back on people who need me." Wow. Wow. "I will never turn my back on people that need me." That is such a great quote, because what it does is it basically illustrates exactly how beautiful of a character she is, but also as a person. See, the thing is, when children watch the show and they hear that, they're gonna grow up kind of reciting it in their head. It almost becomes like a mantra for them. So there's a lot of material here for kids to learn, but also for adults to learn too, especially in 2020. All right, so let's talk about Sokka. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you to the most matured character in the series, because he went from being totally in over his head in terms of, oh, I can take anyone, I can fight everybody, and then being humbled and eventually feeling helpless, and then getting his solo episode in Sokka's Master and learning how to handle a sword. But above all else, he, you can tell, was dealing with daddy issues. He wanted to see his father, and Papa Sokka, we're gonna keep calling him Papa Sokka, really was either in prison for most of the series or just away on duty. He was just fighting a war, right, that he knew that he couldn't win alone. But Sokka so badly wanted to be his father, and then when his dad gave him the reins and let him lead the army into battle towards the end of the season, it's almost like Sokka's dad looked up to him. So a child who so badly wanted to be his father, it ended up turning around, right? Sokka now became the person that his dad looked up to. And if that ain't beautiful writing, I don't know what is. Okay, so let's get into Toph. I'm not wearing green because of the Earth Kingdom. I'm wearing green because it's just, you know, my jersey. But Toph is just a great character. Every time I think of Toph, I think of more reasons to like her. And not only that, but oh my gosh, her bending abilities were insane and brought about some of the most beautiful bits of animation in the series, let alone the season. Toph was Iron Man before there was an Iron Man. Not really, but you get it. And she was just such a wonderful surprise when she joined the group in book 2. However, in book 3, I wish we would have gotten more of her. If that's an unpopular opinion, let me know in the comments below, but I really do believe that Toph could have been a bit more, right? She was already a pretty well-developed character, and the writers did very, very well to include her in these dire moments, in these situations. I mean, geez, Sokka is the one holding onto her hand before Toph almost lets go. That's insane. But my thing is, I wanted more of Toph's solo moments. I felt like the rest of the crew, they felt vindicated, right? They got their moments. But for me, Toph always kind of felt like she was in that supporting role, when I do believe that she was a main character for most of season 2 leading into season 3. However, even though she didn't get her moment to shine in book 3 like everyone else in my opinion, I really do believe that her honesty, her brutal honesty, is the only reason why Zuko actually was accepted in the first place by Aang and the gang. Let me tell you guys, if it wasn't for Toph letting them know he's not lying about him wanting to basically right his wrongs, yeah, forget it.
Zuko would not be in this group to begin with.
Okay, we're into the final three main characters here, so let's start talking about Azula. Grey Griffin, I would give you a standing ovation for the rest of my life because the way you acted and the way that this character was able to just come to life and bleed off the screen in terms of emotion, whether it be someone who's thirsty for power or someone who's really looking for a father or mother figure in their lives. Because listen, Azula isn't just someone who's unhinged because she's crazy with power. She really is dealing with trauma. The thing is, Azula and Zuko dealt with the trauma of really not having a strong parent figure in their life differently. See, Zuko went and fought for the greater good, right? To do better than his father. But Azula felt, I can only look to my dad, so I'm gonna go crazy with power, and now I'm frustrated, so I'm just gonna be unhinged. That's the difference in these characters. And then there's that dynamic between Azula, Mei, and Ty Lee, right? Ty Lee and Mei just like totally like turn their backs on Azula. And that's when Azula started to realize, man, am I really alone in this world? And the thing is, I really wish that some of the main group kind of reached out to her and said, hey, we can help you. And that Azula might have then turned good, but I think it was always in Azula's cards where she would just kind of go crazy in a sense and not necessarily want to fight for the betterment of the Fire Nation or of the world, but just for herself. Because she was just frustrated. She was lashing out. And why was she lashing out? Because Ozai is a bad dad. So let's get into the Phoenix King. He's currently serving a life sentence, but we're going to talk about how he wasn't your typical overpowered villain. See, the thing is, we've seen big bad guys like Thanos, for example, in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, who I wouldn't say is a very stereotypical villain because he had some depth to him, but the thing is, Ozai, in my opinion, was so different, right? He wasn't just your big bad dude who we're gonna fight in the end of the season. They kind of built up to him episode by episode by episode. There's a backstory, right? There's depth, there's a layer to his character that is just so powerful. I felt like there were no throwaway moments with him that we're used to seeing in TV shows. Instead, there were just these moments where you started to not empathize with Ozai, but you understood him as a character, and that's beautiful. Okay, time to get into it. Uncle Iroh, the final character we're gonna talk about here. Sorry, I'm getting like a little emotional because this has been one of my favorite characters. Uncle Iroh is just such a beautifully crafted character. He is the father figure for Zuko, but then there's this moment in season 3 where they're all sitting around a campfire and Uncle Iroh becomes the fatherly figure for each of those kids. It's just wonderful. Now, this was the least amount of screen time that we got with Uncle Iroh, and that is due in large part to Mako, the original voice actor, passing away. But Greg Baldwin did an amazing job just to step in and fill that role, and whenever he had to speak, you can tell the difference, honestly. The thing is, I do like that they respected Uncle Iroh's character that, okay, he set everything up, and now he's gonna take a step back and let the kids and Aang and everybody figure it out. And I love that about his character, because eventually we don't see much more of him in the finale. He's with the White Lotus, and yeah, that's about it. And Iroh really is one of the most important characters of Avatar The Last Airbender, because he is the reason Zuko figures out his destiny. If not for Iroh, we don't get this version of Zuko. So yeah, Uncle Iroh, man, one of the best. I love him so much. Now, outside of all of that, guys, there are some questions that remain in my head. The first is, what the heck happened to Zuko's mother? Now, I'm going to believe, because I'm an optimistic viewer, that Zuko eventually gets the answer out of Ozai and goes and finds his mother, brings her back to the Fire Nation, and then they all just live happily ever after. But then another part of me believes, well, they didn't necessarily tell us what happened to Katara's mother, and we're led to believe that she was unfortunately killed by that Fire Nation general, so maybe the same thing happened here, where Ozai didn't necessarily kill his wife on his own, but he actually exiled her without any supplies or any food, and unfortunately she perished out on her own. That's definitely a possibility, but listen, again, gonna be optimistic here, but you guys let me know what you think about that possibility in the comments below. And then there's another one. What the heck happened to Azula? Is she in prison forever, just like her father, or is maybe she exiled, or did she kind of get therapy? I hope. What happened to Azula? But again, guys, those questions are not deal breakers for me. They didn't really hold me back from loving this season or this series. I'm telling you, it's a 10 out of 10. So yes, overall, I loved season 3. It was just wrapping up everything perfectly. All the storylines were fleshed out wonderfully. The illustrations, the animations, the music, the acting,
Everything was just so beautiful about book three. Now, is Avatar The Last Airbender the most perfect series ever? Well, no, because I don't think any series is perfect, but is it among my top five? Absolutely. Is it the best animated show I've ever seen? Yes. Is this a child show? No. It is just beautiful. Children, adults, teenagers, anyone could love this. I mean, a grandparent could love this because they'll probably empathize with Uncle Iroh, but still, it is so beautiful just to see how they fleshed everything out over the span of only three seasons. What this show did in one season, a series traditionally cannot do in about five or six seasons. So go figure, man. Beautiful, beautiful stuff. So you're probably asking me, guys, what's next for my coverage of Avatar and the World Beyond? I'm gonna watch Legend of Korra. I'm gonna rank my favorite Avatar characters because someone asked for that and I've already been planning that out. And yes, I'm still gonna be reviewing movies. I'm gonna be reviewing TV shows. So I really hope you guys will stick along for the journey. But if this is your final stop for my Avatar coverage and you're gonna go on to something else, let me be the first one to tell you, and hopefully not the last. Thank you so much for just everything you've been doing, just your comments, your engagement, not spoiling anything, guys. I didn't get one thing spoiled for me this entire journey. That's beautiful. Thank you for just sticking with me through an hour long worth reaction. It's beautiful. You guys and your support and your love, it's heard, it's appreciated. And honestly, I hope to reciprocate that for you. And yeah, you guys are great. So if you don't want to miss out on any further reviews, of course, guys, go ahead and hit the big red button below and subscribe to the channel. Tap on that bell as well. And don't forget to smash that like button because it does a ton to help out the channel. Also, go ahead and get loud in the comments below and let me know what you thought of book three. Alrighty, guys. Well, this isn't the last time I'm talking about The Last Airbender, but it will be the last time I'm talking about the episodes themselves. Oh, man. Well, All right, I gotta stop getting emotional. Guys, thank you so much for watching, and I'll catch you at the next screening.